thanks for inviting. It's great to be here. And I'm going to talk about Erasure coding for data storage. So let me start with the following motivating slide. So this is the slide that I borrowed from well, it really comes from IDC, so that's some organization that tracks trends in all kinds of IT industry, sub-industries of IT industry. So this curve here shows how much data, how much digital data humanity is generating. So on x-axis, you see the time in years, and on y-axis, we see the amount of data in petabytes. And so if you are not sure what a petabyte is, it's 1,000 terabytes. So after terabyte comes, so 1,000 terabytes gives you a petabyte, 1,000 petabytes give you an exabyte, 1,000 exabytes give a zettabyte. So what it says is that in 2015, humanity generated about 10 zettabytes of data, and this quantity is growing at a very high rate. So by 2020, we are expected to generate about, well, almost 50, so 45 zettabytes. So not all of the data ends up being stored, but a lot of it does end up being stored in data centers around the globe, and therefore it's very important to store it cheaply and efficiently. And anything that we can do to help that is of value. So this is the quest that motivates all this line of work. So historically, how was reliability provided? So how was data stored in data centers in order to be stored reliably? So just in a very simple way. So like every file that has to be stored would just be copied across three different machines in different parts of the data center, or maybe across data centers. And one would hope that all three of these machines don't become unavailable at the same time, so that later we can give the data to the user whenever the user wants it. And this is good in many respects, right? So we can, I will say that it has local reconstruction, right? That means that if a machine is down, then we can immediately get the copy from somewhere. So this is what, like a local, so we don't need to go to talk to many machines, download lots of data, we just have a copy. It's conceptually simple, and at small scale, it's actually very reasonable because machines are not that expensive. At large scale, this is not reasonable. It's even impossible to do it. I mean, if you think about the difference between, say, 50 zettabytes and 150 zettabytes, you really don't want to stretch your data so much. So if this is not a good solution, then what is a good solution? So one thing that one can try doing is use standard erasure correcting codes. And some of them have been used. So the standard thing to do is just to use, a read-solomon code. So what is a read-solomon code? It has two parameters, k and n. So you should think of k as an integer, n as an integer, and n is larger than k. And you fix the two parameters. And then for every file that you want to store, you do the following. You take that file, you chop it into k chunks of the same size. So this is what you do to your file. You chop it. And then you generate n minus k redundant chunks. So the first redundant chunk would be let's say just an XOR of your data chunk. The second would be another kind of linear combination of your data chunks with some coefficients coming from some small finite field. That's the way you generate this chunk and all other chunks as well. So all of them are combinations of data symbols, and then you distribute that across n machines. And what the read-solomon code provides, the guarantee that read-solomon code provides to you is that as long as out of those n machines some k survive, some k are accessible to you, you can take the data from those k machines and recreate your original data. So any k out of n are sufficient for recovery. So this is very nice. And in fact, these codes have been used. So Google at some point was using 6.9 read-solomon in data centers. Microsoft, again, at some point in the past, was using a 6.9 read-solomon. They are implemented in HDFS and in lots and lots of other places. So what is good? Okay, we get much smaller overheads than with three-way replication. So the 6.9 gives us a 1.5 times overhead. So sounds quite attractive. Reliability is actually usually becomes higher than for three-way replication. And again, one can reliability is hard to compute, so to express it as a number, there are ways to do it, and usually even 6.9 would give you higher reliability than replicating data three-way. Now, what is the downside? Well, the main downside is that we no longer have this local reconstruction, right? So if a machine that stores the data that we want is down, it's unavailable, well, the read-solomon code, like 6.9 read-solomon code, would guarantee us that whatever we want, we can recover, right? But then out of this, so if we use the 6.9 code and then one data symbol is missing, well, we can go get data from six other machines, and then from there we can recover what we need. But there is no immediate copy. So we need to talk to many machines, and we need to download a lot of data. So this is the main downside. And this is the main reason why these codes are only very short codes are being used. So 6.9 is considered OK. But you really don't want to use a code which is like 50, 60, let's say. Reliability-wise, it would be very good. The space overhead would be tiny. But then if you lose a machine, you would need to go talk to 50 other machines and download 50 times more data to recover what is missing. And this is prohibitive. So this is not realistic. So this is the story with read Solomon codes. So short codes are good. Long codes are not practical. And then there is this whole line of work, all of this quite recent, on looking for other. So OK, so if read Solomon codes, if classical erasure correcting codes don't fit this application that well, so then what are the codes that would? So can we suggest some codes that would? And then what are these codes? So how should they look like? So and this is the purpose of this talk. So first, let me review what do we want from these codes. Right, so first and predominant, we want to have low redundancy. Because if we didn't care about redundancy, then we would just do three-way replication. We'd be very happy. It's good in all other respects except redundancy. So we want redundancy to be small. The second consideration is reliability. So we want our code to tolerate failures. And failures here are erasures. So a code coordinate is erased. So we never talk about errors. It's just erasures. Because this models what's going on in data center. So a machine is unavailable because there's a network partition, or it's under an upgrade, or something, or it's being rebooted, something else happens. So then we know that that we don't get response from that machine, but we will never get the wrong response. OK, so we want to tolerate failures. And this can be independent failures, like a machine can be unavailable. Or this could be large correlated failures. So say a rack can be down, or the whole data center can be down. So if we code across data centers, one data center is down, we might see, I don't know, like 30% of our machines being unavailable. It could be a power supply failure. Again, the power supply would go to multiple racks typically. So then, again, we are missing lots and lots of symbols in our code. One more important consideration is availability. So what that means is that when a typical failure happens, so be that a data center failure or a machine failure, if we want to access the symbol which is currently unavailable, then we should be able to do that by accessing few other symbols and downloading small amount of data. So this is what we call availability consideration. And finally, we want our codes to be efficient computationally. So what that means in this setting is that, all our codes would be linear, like the same way as read Solomon code is linear. So when we compute these redundant symbols, we take linear combinations of data symbols. We want these linear combinations to have coefficients coming from a small finite field. Because this is what determines computational efficiency of encoding and decoding. If we use coefficients coming from a large field, then multiplication becomes slow. And in the end, it can limit the throughput of our system. So it's important to use small finite fields to define our codes. So and here, as you see, I highlighted some of the requirements that we have in the red. So these are the requirements that make us different from classical problems that have been studied in coding theory for decades. So having low redundancy, dealing with independent failures, and being computationally efficient, all these considerations have been studied by coding theories since the 50s. But what makes these problems different and what gives a unique flavor to the trade-offs that we are going to discuss next are these considerations that are highlighted in the red. So the fact that we have to deal not only with individual coordinate failures, but with these large correlated failures that are typically known in advance at the stage of code design. And this need for locality, so this need to be able to recover individual symbols in the case of correlated or individual failures by accessing a small number of surviving symbols. So these four considerations are what we are after, and in the remainder of the talk, so we'll talk about several families of codes that achieve various trade-offs between these four parameters. So I'll start with locally decodable codes. So this is a family of codes coming from theoretical computer science community that were in fact not designed for applications and storage, but that have a lot of similarity for other codes that people study for this problem. So we'll see the respects and that they are good with respect to these considerations and in some other respects and that they don't do that well. And then I'll go into three different types of codes that were in fact designed for applications and storage. We'll start with regenerating codes coming from electrical engineering community have been proposed about 9 years ago, have a lot of nice properties, haven't seen wide adoption yet, so we'll talk about why and what is in the way of that. Then we'll talk about local deconstruction codes. So this is a new, relatively young and family of codes, and in fact the one that had been adopted quite widely, and about some kind of next generation of LRCs called maximally recoverable LRCs, so, and maximally recoverable codes in general. So this is our plan. And also, so since we are such a small group, so don't hesitate to ask me at any point. I really want to be clear, and we have a lot of time, and I'll be going at a small, slow pace.
I just have a question.
Very good.
About the first slide.
Uh-huh.
So this is assumption of data,
mm-hmm.
and what is the just total disk space?
Oh, right. Yeah, I had this. I removed it. I had another. So in my previous talk, I had that curve there as well, but then I thought that it's not so relevant. So there is a big gap. So how much ends up being stored? Well, about 20% ends up being stored. So 20% is about the capacity that the humanity has.
It's 20%.
About 20%.
Not 1%.
No. A lot of data ends up being stored. Yeah.
Okay. And another question. Imagine we just delete all the repetitions. So I don't know. Many people have their private copy of some movie. If we don't take into account all the repetitions or.
Right.
How much it
I would love to be able to answer that. I don't know. So there are lots and lots of sources of this data, right? There are cameras on the corner of the streets, how much data they generate, and like the CIA doesn't want to delete it, right? And then I know other examples. Like I heard that when a Boeing flies across an ocean, it generates about a terabyte of data every flight. So they end up deleting a lot of it, although they would love to keep it, but it's just too expensive. So they don't see enough value in storing it. They would love to store it, but they don't. So they would only probably store the recent ones, but they would want to store the whole history. There's a lot of demand, so if data storage were cheaper, much more data would end up being stored. Yep.
So this is the amount that is being stored?
No, that's the amount that's being generated. That's how much we generate every year. No, yeah, so by far not all of it ends up being stored. Any more questions? Yeah, but it's remarkable how much data we generate.
Also, there is a feeling that the data is somehow very clearly distinguished in different categories. One is stored for years
mm-hmm.
without any processing. Mm-hmm. Just you have a recording there. And there are some part of data which is actively
Yeah, the vast majority of data is very, very cold. So this is people in storage community would call it cold data. So data which is essentially never accessed.
Yeah.
And the vast majority of data is extremely cold. Yeah,
but then it will be logical to have different types of codes for different types
yes.
of data.
Yes, all of this is for cold storage. Mm-hmm. So when I talk about that, so all of these codes are intended for cold storage. Because when you talk about data which is frequently accessed, first of all, you would want to have multiple copies just in order to be able to serve requests. So then, yeah, for data which is hot, you want to have multiple copies. All of this is just for data which is at least somewhat cold.
But if I lost my mail for 10-year-old mail, I would safely wait a day before it will be reconstructed from some machines in
So this is not these are not the typical expectations that the user has. I mean, if you search your inbox and you click on a mail from 10 years back, you expect to see it in seconds, right? You don't expect to wait for a day.
But it's like hot data, no?
Well, no, an email which is 10 years old, so it will be coded like that. Like if it's an email stored by Microsoft, it would be coded with this code.
So your definition of cold is something that is not being altered, or is it something that's not being accessed?
Oh, so yeah, and also, yeah, all of this, so not being accessed is called immutable. When I'm talking about data, it's cold and immutable. So it's data which is not modified and which is cold. And this is like 98% of the data that the world has. It's cold and immutable.
I think the problem with what you're describing is that we don't know what is really cold. In the sense, I have my repository of 10-year-old mail, and I might want to access one of those things at some point. And in that case, I do want it soon. It is for the longest time. Most of these mails are not going to be accessed, but one of them is. I don't know which one.
Right. So the REST services, like say Amazon has, they call it Glacier. Microsoft probably also has something like that. So where you can give them data and they'll store it in some format, and then the promise is that, yeah, I mean, your access time would be a day, let's say. So yes, it would be much, much cheaper. So then they'll use tape or hard drive, but then they'll power them down. In either case, coding would be used. Yeah, when the data is extremely cold, I'll talk about that a little bit. Yeah. But not so much is stored in this way. So most of the data is stored still so that you can access it pretty quickly. Okay, so let me, let's get back to theory. So let me start with locally decodable codes. So as I said, this is a family of codes coming from TCS, statistical computer science community, and really designed for a different purpose. But it's something that you immediately think of when you see these kinds of questions about locality. And let's see so what these codes are and what are they good for. So a locally decodable code, so we have it here on top. So it takes k data symbols, it's a linear code, so it generates some n minus k redundant symbols. Okay, each of these is a linear combination of the data symbols. And the guarantee that the code provides, so the code would have this parameter. So k is the number of data symbols, but then it is also another parameter r called locality. And usually r is much, much less than k. So we can think of k as growing asymptotically, but r is staying like constant or growing very, very slowly with k. So the guarantee is the following. So if we store these n symbols, and then we allow the adversary to come and raise a certain constant fraction of the symbols, arbitrary constant fraction. So let's say arbitrary 10% of the symbols may be erased by an adversary, so the adversary can come and take them away. And then later, if we want to access any symbol, we should be able to do that without having to process all the surviving symbols, but by accessing just r of the symbols that remain. So, right, so 10% of the symbols are gone, and then we want to access some data symbol. If it's there, we are very happy, but if it's not there, we should be able to do that by accessing just r of the surviving symbols, and r is very, very low. So here is an example of a code like that, a very short one. So it's a two query, so here locality is 2, 3-7 code. So it codes 3 symbols to 7 symbols. So I take my 3 symbols, x1, x2, x3, and I code them by appending these 4 redundant symbols, x1, xor, x2, x1, xor, x3, and so on, and xor of all the symbols. This is my code, and so let's say the adversary comes and erases some 3 symbols. So maybe these 3 symbols, x1 is gone, and then 2 of these parishes are gone. And then what is the promise? The promise is that whatever I lost, I can recover by accessing just 2 symbols. So let's see, so let's say that I want to recover x1. Well, how do I do that? Well, I read these 2 symbols. I read x1, xor, x3, and x1, xor, x2, xor, x3. So if I XOR these 2 together, I get back X1. Yeah, so this is the trick. And it would work, in fact, for any 3 symbols being erased. So this is an example of a locally decodable code. So these codes have been studied for a long time, longer than any other family that I'll mention. A lot is known about them. So one can think of trying to use a code like that for storage, right? Then we don't need even to think about this layout, about these racks, about these data centers. So because we have to deal with large correlated failures, right? So here we can even forget about correlated. We can deal with any large failure. So any 10% of symbols are gone. I don't care about which ones, what was the reason for them being gone, because I know that still, whatever symbol I miss, I can recover it by using as few of the surviving symbols. I get fast reconstruction after arbitrary large failures and a good rich mathematical theory behind these objects. The trouble with them is they need a lot of redundancy. They probably need a lot of redundancy. So if we talk about codes with locality 2, so where we just read 2 symbols in order to do our recovery, then in fact their length has to be exponential, so it has to be 2 to the k. So they just need so much redundancy, so 3-way replication is way, way more frugal than these codes. If we allow larger number of queries, redundancy would go down, but we would really need to push the number of queries to be pretty high in order to get small redundancy. So there is this recent paper building on some earlier work that, with query complexity, which is 2 to the square root of k, gives us small redundancies, redundancy which is just a fraction of k by Coparte and co-authors. But again, so first, it only applies when k is really large. And even then, you would be still reading quite a lot. So this 2 to the square root of k is still pretty large quantity. Okay, so these are locally decodable codes. So they serve the same purpose, but they give us very aggressive guarantee, which we don't really need in the setting. And they give us it at a very high cost that we don't want to pay. So now let's move to the generating code. So this is the first family of codes that was, in fact, designed specifically for these storage applications with exactly this goal of kind of using them in data centers. So it's exact code designed exactly for this purpose, and let's see what are these and what they can do for us. So first, let's start again with read-solmon codes, with the simplest code. So let's look at the 2-4 read-solmon code. It takes two data symbols, let it be X and Y, and appends two parity symbols, P1 and P2. And so what is the guarantee that this code gives us? Well, as I said, any two symbols out of these four surviving suffice to recover the data. So no matter which two symbols are taken away, from the other two, I can recover the data. So, but know that it doesn't matter whether I lose two symbols. Well, I'll need to read twice more than I'll need to access two nodes and read twice more data than I lost to recover what I lost. Or whether I lose just one symbol, let's say I just lose one symbol, X. Well, if I want to recover it, I'll still need to read twice more than I lost. So no matter whether I have two failures or one failure, I'm still reading twice more, I'm still reading two symbols to recover. So this observation that there is this obvious discrepancy between kind of losing single symbol or two symbols. So this discrepancy, the fact that, I mean, after different kinds of failures, we are still doing the same kind of reconstruction. So this was, observed like probably I don't know who kind of first pointed that out, but DeMarcus and his collaborators were the ones who said, okay, so we need codes that actually separate between these two cases. We need codes that in the case of a single failure would do small amount of work because this is a small failure. But in the case of a large failure, when we lose, say, N minus K symbols, well, okay, so in that case, they can do a lot of work because this is a big failure. And then how do we do that? So this is a simple code that follows this philosophy, that implements this philosophy. Apparently, it can be implemented, so that's the main insight. That implement this philosophy, and okay, so this is our 2-4 code. So I have two data symbols. The first data symbol is this. So when I think about a symbol now, I partition it into two sub-symbols. So a symbol now for me is not a single entity, but it comes partitioned into two sub-symbols. So the first symbol is x1, x2. So this is my first data symbol. The second data symbol is y1, y2. So this is the second data symbol. And then when I encode, I generate two redundant symbols. So the first redundant symbol is given by this formula. So its top half would be x1, xor, y1. The bottom half would be x2, xor, y2. And then here is the rule for computing the second data symbol. And the claim is the following. The first claim is that, well, if I lose two symbols, then I can still recover all what I lost. So in this I won't prove. You can verify it just by really trying every pair of symbols or by writing out some system of linear equations. That claim, you just have to believe me, that if any two symbols are gone in this picture, you can still recover all what we lost. Yep. The symbols are still the big ones. But the big symbol has its own internal parts, but we think of it as a single symbol. Yep.
So we just take a code which is resilient to one erasure and somehow extend it by adding the last column to get it.
Well, we extend it in a very specific way, and it's an important way of extending it.
Yeah. The part of this code is...
Yes. That's true. So yeah, a part of the code would be resilient to one erasure.
1.5x means we need on average this much symbol.
No, it's not even an average, so this is the worst case. So let me show you. Oops.
I just don't understand what's the half of the symbol.
Right. Yeah, so let me show you. So these are the halves. If we lose two symbols from the remaining two, we can recover all what we lost. But if we lose just one data symbol, then we don't need to read twice more than what we lost. We can just read 1.5 times more than what we lost. And here is how we do that. So here is the example. So let's say that the first symbol is gone. So x1, x2 is gone. Now I want to recover x1, x2. So I won't read any two symbols. I would read the half from each of the three remaining symbols. Yeah, I did three halves, and that's how I get 1.5. So 1.5 times the lost data. Yeah. Yes. Yeah, but that's fair. I mean, I want to know how much worse I'm doing compared to replication. With replication, it would be one, no matter how I partition my things inside. So here I do 1.5. Right. So if I lose x1, x2, well, I would read y1 from the first symbol, x1, xor, y1 from the second symbol, and x2 is for y1 from the third symbol. So, and it's clear that I can cancel y1 from this axis, and I get back my symbol, my x. And if I would do the same, so let's say if I lost a y, I lost a y symbol, again, then I can read a half from each of the remaining symbols, and things work out, right? So I would read x2, x2 XOR y2, and x2 XOR y1. And again, I can cancel x2 from these linear combinations, and I get back these y's that I lost. So so this is very nice, right? I mean, so now I'm not reading twice times more. So in the typical failure scenarios, and these are really the cases that I care about, I am reading just 1.5 times more. So I got savings, and I got them for free, because when I don't pay anything extra in terms of space compared to Reed Solomon, but I have this very nice property. And here, of course, one would immediately ask, okay, so can we do better than 1.5? Can we generalize it to arbitrary k and n, or is it specific to 2 and 4? Can we do this for redundant symbols or just for parity? So, and people have looked at all these questions, so there is a lot of, there are hundreds of papers about these objects, and all of these are answered. Yeah?
So you're only trying to recover data symbols?
So this code only does it for data symbols, but you can do it for parities as well. And also for free, so with no...
Definition typically favors one or the other, or either?
So they look at both, they look at both. And yeah, so there are many related definitions. It's quite a literature. So this is a theorem that kind of it's on the end of line of research for this direction, but it answers many questions. So it says that it's a theorem due to Von Tama and Brook from maybe about 3 years ago. So what they say is the following. So in fact, you can take k and n to be arbitrary. It doesn't have to be 2-4. You can look at any k and any n. And there will, and it is a k comma n code, so a code that takes k symbols, extends them to n symbols, which is MDS. So MDS means that it has this Reed Solomon property that if any k symbols out of n survive, we can get the data back. So we can get the MDS property, and when we just lose a single symbol, be the data or parity, it doesn't matter. So if we just lose a single symbol, if we want to recover it, we would need to access not k times more data than what we lost, but just n minus 1 over n minus k times more data than what we lost. And moreover, this quantity is optimal, so this cannot be reduced. So you cannot have a theorem like that where this quantity is reduced by anything. So this is a tight answer.
So n is basically
under 6. Yeah, n and k are under 6, so you can plug in any numbers.
So there are some values of n and k for which the code exists.
No, it exists for all n and k. So. Okay. For all k, for all n, there exists a code like this, where which would be MDS, and where if you lose a single symbol, you're just downloading that much to recreate that symbol. Yeah, so with this construction, it's n minus k to the k plus 1, so it's enormous. So in order to get that bound, you have to blow up your symbol, you have to, they call it partitioning, so you have to partition each of the symbols into n minus k to the k plus 1 subsymbols. So this is, this is a...
The alphabet is of size 2 to this number.
Yes, the alphabet is of size 2 to this number. So it's a theoretical result.
So in terms, if you consider this a kind of binary code, you mean that you are losing blocks, so that all the erasures are made by
yes.
Big blocks.
Yes, but it's a fair assumption, because when you lose, say, a disk or a computer, I mean, you lose a lot of data there. So you can think of it as a sequence of blocks. Why not?
Yeah, so this bound is still practical. If it's the size of the disk, probably it's okay.
Well, no, it's still not okay. It's still not okay because for many reasons. Well, really, the reason that these codes are not used, it's not even in this bound. But this bound is not practical, because although the disk does have a lot of bits, I mean, when you count this, how much, when you say, okay, so I download just so much more than I lost, how do I accomplish that? You read various subsymbols from various pieces, but you really don't want to read a single bit from a disk.
Yeah.
I mean, you could as well read a few megabytes, because that's how, if you move the disk head, you could as well, like, it's moving the disk head which creates trouble. While you can fit so many bits on a disk, you don't want to use a code like that. Yeah?
Do you mean here,
No.
Subspecific.
Subspecific.
I assume that this specific is arbitrary.
No, the claim is the following. So, the code is MDS. So, if any n minus k are erased, you can read everything what remains and you can recover what you lost. But if there is just one symbol which is missing, like in the previous picture, we had just one symbol X which is missing, just one big symbol. Just one big symbol is missing, then in order to recover it, there is a recipe that will tell you, okay, so if you want to recover symbol number 20, then you need to go and read so many symbols, so many pieces from different subsymbols, and those together by some, combined together by some clever linear combinations would give you what you lost. So, but these symbols are there. This is the assumption. The assumption is that you lost just one big symbol. So there is a family that you have to read, but it's dispersed all over the remaining n-1 symbols, but yeah, it's there. So. There are generalizations saying what happens if you lose two symbols, three symbols. But this is the main theorem. And the main question, of course, is after one symbol. So what happens after you lose a single symbol?
And they are linear.
They're additive. So like they're not linear as like this code that I defined here. Yeah. It's not a linear code over this big field. Like if you think of coordinates, right, then you cannot do multiplication by a field element. But it's additive in the sense that every subsymbol that you store is a linear combination of subsymbols. So a sum of two code words is a code word, but you cannot multiply by elements of the outer field, of the big
and
field.
What kind of technique you use to construct this right. phase of combining things?
Right, so it's some combinatorics, mixture of algebra and combinatorics. Nothing particular, so yeah, nothing super deep, but it's clever combinatorics.
So, for example, involving extractors or just something more
elementary. Just something, yes, elementary combinatorics. Yeah, it's more elementary, yeah. So this is the result. So you pointed out this exponential dependence. So the dependence is exponential, and moreover, there are lower bounds for certain regimes, saying that, in fact, if you want to get your recovery cost so low, so all the way up to this n minus 1 over n minus k, then you have to have an exponential redundancy here. It doesn't apply to all ranges, so now it talks about for certain k's and for certain n's. So assuming your n is close to k, so the overhead is low, then this has to be exponential. So like it won't be this exponential function, it will be some weaker exponential function, but there are exponential lower bounds. But this isn't such a big of a concern for the reason that, well, okay, so you really, it's not clear that you need to go all the way down up to this n minus 1 or n minus k. What you definitely want to do is bit-read Solomon, right? You don't want to download k times more because that is high. But even if you download not k times more, but say root k times more, or I don't know, you might decrease this number quite a bit. So this is not completely understood. So saying, okay, so if I need to get to here, in their language, this is called cutset bound, this is called subpacketization. So if I want to get to cutset bound, I need exponential subpacketization. But then if I go just all the way, say half the way to cutset bound, then I get away with polynomial subpacketization. So this is an active area of research, so that not everything is known. A lot of most questions are open. But the truth is that if you are only happy with subpacketizing into say four symbols or six symbols, you can immediately save a lot on the Solomon. How much exactly is not known, but in this sense, this idea is very useful. And at the same time, these codes are not being deployed. So, and the reason that they are not deployed, okay, so let's talk about their good features. Good feature is tiny space overhead. Like, they're as good as Reed Solomon, right? So we are not paying anything extra in terms of redundancy compared to Reed Solomon, and we can read very small amount of data if just single node fails, which is the typical case. And there is rich mathematical theory being, so people work on that, so the body of human knowledge about this is growing. So the main downside is that, well, typically what happens is that machines don't fail for long. So a machine is rebooted, machine is under an upgrade, so there is some failure that is going to be fixed in like half an hour. So in that case, you don't want to rebuild the data that is unavailable. What you want is to serve requests to the users for the data. And then user requests are typically not very large. So user would come and ask for an email, for a megabyte, for 2 megabytes. So, but if the user is asking for a megabyte, then it doesn't matter that much how much data you would download when you serve this request. What is much more important is how many machines you are going to talk to when you do this reconstruction. Because this will determine how long the user would have to wait to see the request, to see the answer to his request. And while these codes save a lot on bandwidth, they lose on the number of machines which are being accessed compared to Reed Solomon. And that's the reason that, at least I am not aware of any of them being deployed in real large-scale systems so far. So they would be good for very cold storage. So yeah, if it's okay for a user to wait for a long time, and then the only need that we really want to take care of is to keep our data. When a machine fails, we want to rebuild all the data on that machine. In this case, we certainly care about bandwidth more than about the number of machines that we access. So probably eventually they'll be used. So far, I don't know of any uses of this code. So this is it for what I wanted to say with regenerating codes. And then our next subject is local reconstruction codes. So this is this recent family that, as I said, which is being actually used. So let's see how these codes look like. So what is our definition here? So here we'll define very clearly what we want. We want to minimize the number of machines that we access on recovery, right? So here is our definition. So our code is systematic, so it takes K data symbols. It does encoding by appending, by generating some number of redundant symbols. And it has two additional parameters, R and H. So R measures locality. So if any single symbol is erased, and we allow erasures both in parity symbols and in data symbols. One can look at the case where we only care about locality for data symbols, has been looked at. But for this talk, let's say that we care about erasures both in data symbols and in parity symbols. So if just one symbol is erased, we should be able to recover it by accessing at most R of the surviving symbols. This is one requirement. And the other requirement is our reliability requirement. So now let's say that, if there are up to H plus one erasures, so if up to H plus one symbols are erased or are unavailable, then we are allowed to access everything. But we should be able to recover all the data back. So this is our second requirement. So we have two requirements. So this is our definition. Okay. So the first thing to ask here. Okay. So what is the redundancy, right? So how much do we have to stretch our data to get these two requirements? And this one can apparently answer. And there was a paper by Gopalan et al. In 2012, where the following bound was proved. So if you have an R, H LRC, so this local reconstruction code, then redundancy is at least K over R plus H. And for almost all K and R and H, this is tight. There are some cases where it's not tight, but then it's tight within plus one. So you can get these codes, and your redundancy would be this quantity plus one. So it's up to plus one. This is in fact the right answer. So this is the first theorem. So good. So now we know the redundancy. So now we know, if you want these two nice properties, how much do we have to pay in terms of redundancy? Well, this is how much we need to pay. Moreover, one can in fact prove a stronger statement, and there is a theorem again in the same paper, which says that, okay, so these codes are, so okay, so now let's, since we know what the optimal redundancy is, let's constrain our attention just to optimal codes, just to codes that have this minimal possible redundancy. And there is the next theorem that says, so these codes, they're all very similar. They're all very similar, and they look pretty much the same. So how do they look like? So we'll have a lot of pictures like this here. So let me try to convey well what this picture is. So let's think that we want to build a code like that. That we want to build a code that provides us with these two guarantees. So if there are up to H plus one erasures, then we can recover all the data. And then if just one symbol is missing, then we should be able to read at most R other symbols and get that symbol back. So how would we build it? Well, the natural way would be to start with something like a Reed Solomon. So the red symbols here are our data symbols. They're X's X1 through XK, right? These are our data symbols. So we'll start with something like a Reed Solomon. So we'll take the data symbols and using something similar to Reed Solomon code, we'll generate H redundant symbols. And these are my black symbols, H1 through H sub H.
And at this point, we ignore the ordering.
Yes, we completely ignore the ordering of symbols. Yeah. And we will be ignoring it actually pretty much all the way. So
are we viewing an entire column as a single letter of a big alphabet?
No.
This is no longer the ordering.
No longer. Yeah, no longer the whole picture. So here, every square, it's a symbol. And symbols are indivisible. So they come from a finite field, and we never look inside of them. So they are, of course, they come from a big finite field, so they are not bits. But we never look inside, so every single symbol, it's a packet, it's an entity, so we never look inside. So now my data symbols are these red ones, X1 through XK, And I'm trying to design a code that would, I'm trying to design this R, H LRC. And I'm saying, okay, so how would I do that? So here's my attempt at that. I'll take this K data symbols, and I will generate H redundant symbols. These are the black symbols, H1 through HH. And let's say I'll just use a read Solomon code to generate this. Or in the end, read Solomon would not be such a good idea, but some other kind of standard error correcting code. So H1 would be some linear combination of X's, and then H2 would be some linear combination of all X's with some coefficients. So, okay. And if it's a read Solomon code, then already now I have this nice property that any H of these are gone, I can recover all the data. This is what read Solomon code guarantees for me. It's not exactly H plus one. Here I wanted H plus one, but at least I do H. So H symbols are gone, I'm happy I can recover everything. Well, but so far I don't have the second.
Sorry, in this picture, what are the vertical columns? If you erase what? When you say simultaneous erase?
Yeah, I haven't got to the blocks. So far, imagine that there are no boxes, yeah. And these are just the squares, just the top three lines of squares.
And erasure is individual squares.
Erasure is an erasure of an individual square. Yeah. So now I want to get the second property. If there is an erasure, so erasure of a single square is gone, then I want to be able to recover it by reading at most R symbols. And again, the naive way of doing that would be just the following. I'll take my symbols X's and H's, and I'll group them into groups of size R together. So, and then for every group of size R, I would compute the local parity of the group. So let's say my R is 3, then I would take X1, X2, and X3, and I would compute their XOR, and then I would store their XOR there. And then for the next three symbols, H1, X4, and X5, again, I'll compute their XOR, I will say, okay, this is my new symbol. I'm also going to store it. And I'll do it for every group. And say, okay, now this is my code. So this is my code, and so what are these boxes? These boxes are these local groups. It's just this box, this orange box, so shows that, say, that this symbol, it's an XOR of H1, X4, and X5. So these are the boxes. So let's see. So did I get what I wanted? Well, I definitely have the second property, right? Because one symbol is gone, no matter which one, I can recover it by reading the other symbols in the local group. Because the local group because I have the local parity which XORs the symbols together. So if I lose X1, I can read X2, X3, and this XOR, and I can get back X1. Very simple. Well, do I get the first property? It's not so immediate, right? Because the read Solomon code that I started with, well, it had it gave me the promise that if out of these top three rows, if H symbols are gone, I can recover all what I lost. Now I'm talking about H plus one symbols. Well, these top three rows wouldn't take care of that, but now I have the local parities. Apparently, it's possible. So apparently, if I define these heavy parities, these H's, if I pick my linear combinations there correctly, then by adding local parities, I actually buy myself a guarantee that if H plus one symbols are gone, I can still recover everything. So it's not immediate, so it actually takes some amount of work. So this is the theorem of Tama and Barg that in fact you can do this, and you don't need large coefficients to do that. You can get this this property over field size of size about K plus H. So this is possible.
Mm-hmm. To make a column unusable, uh-huh. You need to erase two places.
Yes.
So it should be like 2H if you put all the H's in one, distribute them between columns. Then you need 2H to destroy.
Yeah. Let me scroll a little bit.
Each column will have 1H.
So let's look at this picture. So on this picture, we have a code. It's kind of the same picture that we had, right? But now there are five symbols which are being erased. I'm not erasing two in every column. That would take eight, right? That would be 10. I'm just erasing five.
Yeah.
And you can already not correct
that. Good.
Yeah, but we'll get to here. So let me go back. So, right, okay, so what did we do on the slide? So we gave the definition of R, H local reconstruction codes. So these are codes that satisfy these two requirements. So locality, so one symbol is gone, I read at most R, and then the worst case reliability guarantee, H plus one symbols are gone, I can read everything, but I should be able to recover everything. We said that we know redundancy, we know the optimal redundancy, and then we said that, there is this structure theorem that says that if you have a code with optimal redundancy, then it should actually look like this. Then you can rearrange its symbols and you will get something that does look like this. So all these codes that are optimal, they're all kind of naive in that they're more or less the first thing you would try in order to get them to work. Because, I mean, when we just thought about how would we do that, I mean, that's what we ended up doing. And this is the only way to get these optimal LRCs. We didn't specify it entirely, so there is some art in picking coefficients at heavy parities, but at this point we don't need that. So these optimal LRCs, they have this very very simple structure, and if you want, so locality and distance essentially come kind of from different sources. So locality just comes from the fact that we add this column parities, local group parities, and distance comes from the fact that we have heavy parities. Okay. Good. So, but now we'll talk about something Sasha pointed to. It's the question of, okay, so if code like that, it tolerates any pattern of H plus one erasures. But out of these codes, are some codes better than others? And this is this concept of maximal recoverability that we'll be discussing in the remainder of the talk. So what is maximal recoverability? So again, let's look at a simple example of a code of an optimal LRC. So we have our symbols arranged in this grid, and for every grid we have a local parity, and then we have our red data symbols and our black symbols, which are heavy parity. So each black symbol is a linear combination of all data symbols. So what are our parameters here? So here R is 3, right? Because when single symbol is erased, we read 3 symbols, so R is 3. And H, the number of heavy parities, is also 3, so 3 heavy parities. So a code like that, by definition, should tolerate any 4 erasures, so any 4 symbols missing. So if we lose 4 symbols, say like these 4 symbols, we have to correct it. So a code like that should correct it. That's our definition. Now, there are some patterns of 5 erasures that we wouldn't be able to correct, no matter how we define a code like that, no matter how clever we are in setting coefficients at heavy parities, we wouldn't be able to correct this pattern, right? So how do we see that? So why is this not correctable? So does anyone want to volunteer suggesting why this is not correctable?
No, I don't understand. Uh-huh. For example, why we need to erase the bottom thing.
Good.
This local parity for the first code. Because if it's not erased...
Actually, it should be moved. Yeah, it's a good question. This is correctable. Because this is correctable, right? I made a mistake. Because this one we can fix. We can decode it by the column, right? We know this D, so we can fix that. And then these are just 4 erasures, and any 4 are correctable. So it's good that nobody volunteered saying why it's not correctable. This is correctable, but then there is a pattern of 5 erasures which is not correctable. So let's say that I would move this one from the bottom, if I move it to X5. Then I claim that this will not be correctable. Let's say that I would, and this one I would move to X4 to make it easier for us. So I would move this one to X4, this one to X5. And I claim this will be not a correctable.
No, but it's still clear because you don't specify what is the error correction code. Theoretically, one can imagine that the usage of this local, so of course we can use the local checksum to correct one error, but maybe we also can use it to get some additional information about big things. And
let's say that it's a pattern of 6 failures, and I raise just this subgrid, so I raise these two and these two, and then let me prove to you that it's not correctable. Good. So let me prove to you that this is, if I erase this subgrid, then this is not a correctable failure pattern. So why is that? Well, I can think of X as variables, right? And then I can just count linear constraints that bound these variables. So, well, if I think of X as variables, then I miss 5 variables, X1, X2, X3, X4, and X5. And then let's count the linear constraints that bind these variables. So there would be one linear constraint coming from this column, one linear constraint coming from this column, and then the heavy parities, H2 and H3. And there would not be a single other linear constraint on these 5 variables. And if I have 5 linear constraints and 4 variables, I cannot correct. I cannot decode. No matter how, no matter what the linear constraints are, right? No matter how I set coefficients in my heavy pairages, this will not be a correct row failure pattern.
So that even suggests that if you want to create non-arrayable patterns, you pick many from the same column.
Yes, yes. You want
to minimize the number of constraints.
Yes, you want to hit as few columns as possible. That's the way to. Yeah. So,
but you still assume that this H unknown Heavy, Reed Solomon or whatever, H are linear.
Yeah, they're linear.
Ooh. If you don't assume that, maybe there is still some way to get it.
No, it's information theory, right? I mean, if you miss five entities, the entities that you get are of the same size, right? The entities that you, like, if, no, it's information theoretically would not be possible. There isn't a bijection between five entities and four entities. So, like, there would be a collision. So you look at this four, and then there would two different fives that map to the same values there. So even nonlinear, you wouldn't be able to correct that. This question of nonlinearity, so for maximal recoverability, nobody had looked at it. Although this kind of, here the argument generalizes immediately, but say if you talk about redundancy, then there are papers that generalize is bound to nonlinear codes. good, so okay, so but the only, really of course this particular pattern is not very important, but the claim that I wanted to make here is that, well, so there is something that the definition of the code guarantees us, right, so say all four patterns are correctable. For patterns of six failures, there would be some that are not correctable, no matter how we define our code. As long as we stick to this topology, right, as long as we stick to this having three heavy pairages and having these columns, here is a pattern of six failures that we would not correct. But at the same time, there are many larger, much larger failure patterns, like this failure pattern, which in fact has eight erasures. That might be correctable or might not be correctable. It doesn't follow from the definition of our code, whether we correct it or whether we do not correct it. So let's look at this failure pattern. So if there are eight erasures, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and I claim that this might be correctable or might not be correctable. So let's, again, we just use our simple linear algebra intuition. First thing we note is that if you look at the last two columns, then we can actually correct these erasures, right? We look at the last column, well, there is a linear dependency here, so we can fix that, so we can correct that symbol. We look at this column, again, we can decode for this symbol, so we can just remove these two erasures. And now there are six variables that we are missing, right? Six, x1, x3, x4, x5, so on, six variables. But let's count linear constraints that bind them. Well, there is one linear constraint coming from the column, right? Since we know x2 and we know the xor, we can figure out what is the sum of these two variables. Then we can figure out what is the sum of these two variables, and then we can figure out what is the sum of these two variables. So this gives us three different linear constraints. And then every h would give us some linear dependence, some linear constraint on all six variables. And we'll get h from h1, from h2, because we know h2, we can decode it from the column, and from h3. So we give six variables, six linear constraints. Maybe it's enough, maybe it's not enough. So if it happens that our system of linear equations is underdetermined, well, bad luck, but maybe it's not, and then we should be able to decode. It's not clear, so it we might be able to decode. So, and of course we want to decode, right? When we design a code and we deploy it, we want to deploy a code that corrects everything which one would hope to correct, right? We want our code to be as reliable as the topology constraints allow. Topology constraints come from the fact that we want this locality, we cannot alter them. Well, we want minimal redundancy and locality. So, and then our structure theorem that tells us that our code would have to look like that. But at least among these codes, we want the most reliable one, right? And and then we wanted to correct everything that one could hope to correct. And this is in fact the definition of maximal recoverability. So once one has a topology specified, and topology, so in this case, it's just this rule saying that, well, there would be there are data symbols, and then we store they're arranged in groups, and then, yeah, so we store this XOR for every group, and then the heavy pairages, and the only freedom we have is setting up this heavy pairage, defining it in the best possible way. We want to instantiate these heavy pairages, we want to instantiate our topology, so that every failure pattern that one could hope to correct would be correctable. So this is the definition of a maximally recoverable code, a maximally recoverable instantiation of a topology. So, and here, one thing we could ask, okay, so but what are these failure patterns? What are these failure patterns that we say that if, that we are talking about? So how do they look like? What's the combinatorial classification of failure patterns correctable by maximally recoverable code in this topology? And for this topology, in fact, there is a combinatorial classification. So it's the following. So a failure pattern will say, okay, so a failure pattern for an optimal Arkham HLRC is regular if there is the following, if we can obtain it by the following process. We erase at most one symbol in every local group. So a local group for us is a column, and then H more symbols on top of that. So anything that we can generate by this process, we want to be able to correct. So this is what we call regular. So everything that can be generated by the process is called regular. So this is a regular failure pattern, right? Because we can generate it by erasing one symbol in every local group, and then say three more of these ones. This is another regular failure pattern. We can generate it by hitting every local group once, so we just erase this row, and then we erase three more coordinates. So this is also a regular failure pattern. And there is a theorem that says that, well, if a pattern is not regular, then no matter how we instantiate our heavy parities, no matter how we instantiate our topology, we would not be able to correct it. At the same time, there is a way to define these heavy parities in such a way that every regular failure pattern becomes correctable. So, and this is this notion of maximally recoverable LRCs, so maximally recoverable codes, the most reliable ones, and not only in terms of distance, so not only like you correct all patterns of size up to something, you correct everything that you can hope to correct given the topology constraints.
Yeah. So you need some kind of random
matrices, yeah.
For...
Yeah, random would do that, exactly. So one way to get this, in fact, the easiest way to prove that such a thing exists is, yeah, the argument is due to Blaum, Hafner, and Heitner. It's a pretty simple argument. You say that, okay, let's set coefficients at random from a very, very large finite field, and then correctability of a pattern can be expressed as a statement that some polynomial takes non-zero value. It's a lot of polynomials, you look at all of them, take their product, use Fuzzy lemma, and so it's a standard argument, and it will tell you that, in fact, that's the way to prove that a code like that exists. The downside of going through this argument is that you end up with a very large finite field. You end up, so this claim is true, code exists, but in fact one can prove that, you know, if you do random assignment, then you definitely do need a big field. Not only if you follow this argument, you end up with a big field. If you do random assignment over a small field, you probably will not get, with high probability, you will not get a maximally recoverable code. So for this kind of argument to go through, you need your field size to behave like k to the h. So if h is small, might not be that bad. If h is large, k is large, you don't want to do that. So, and here we come to this key trade-off in the design of these codes. So on one hand, we want maximal recoverability because it gives us ultimate reliability guarantee given the locality constraints. But on the other hand, the natural way to get it, kind of the easy way to get it by random assignment, only works when the underlying finite field is very large. And we don't want to use large finite fields. So in here we hear this trade-off between field size, which is our computational efficiency consideration, and maximal recoverability, which is our reliability consideration. So we want to get both, but that's hard. And let me say that that this phenomena applies, in fact, much more broadly. So this notion of maximal recoverability, one can discuss it in other topologies in other practically relevant topologies. So here we said that our topology came just from the fact, from a structure theorem, saying if we want minimal redundancy for Arkham H codes, then the codes should have this structure. They should have this topology. In other cases, you might want to consider a particular topology because of other reasons. And you would still ask this question, okay, so for a different topology, what are maximally recoverable codes? So what can they correct? And what is the smallest finite field over that you can have them? So let me define, on this slide, I'll define a class of topologies. So this is pretty broad class, but it in fact captures a lot of what people are actually using in data centers. And then the notion of maximal recoverability kind of very naturally extends to this class. So here, we have our symbols arranged in an M times N grid. So we have M rows, we have N columns. And we have data symbols, so these are the red symbols. And we have heavy parities, so these are the black symbols. So we take our data symbols we compute some number of heavy parities. We have complete freedom in terms of how we compute them. And then we take all these and we arrange them in the subgrid. So this is an M minus A times N minus A subgrid. And then we complete the subgrid to a larger grid. So we extend the subgrid to a larger grid so that every row in this large subgrid is a code word in some read Solomon type code. So every row is redundant. So every row uses an N minus BN MDS code. Every column uses, again, some M minus A M MDS code. So, and this is the complete specification. So in order to instantiate this topology, we need to specify three things. We need to say, how do we compute the heavy parities? So how is each heavy parity computed from data symbols? And then what is the row code that we'll be using? And then what is the column code that we'll be using? So what we end up, so it's called the tensor code. So if you have a matrix like that, and every row is a code word and some code, every column is a code word and some code, this is called the tensor code. So we end up with a tensor code, and in instantiation of this topology has to specify how we compute heavy parities, and then what is the row code that we use, what is the column code that we use. So any questions here? So there are five parameters, so M and N, so this is just the size of the grid. So M is the number of rows, N is the number of columns, and then ABH. So A is redundancy, so number of redundant symbols in a column. B is the number of redundant symbols in a row, and H is the number of heavy parities. So how many heavy parities we plug in here? How many of these do we have?
But you also want the remaining line also to be consistent, so there are some conditions for the write down.
Oops.
Because they should be computed for this and for this in a consistent way.
Well, no, that you get for free. That gets it just comes from linearity.
Basically, it's a product code.
It's
bound to be linear.
Exactly. Yeah.
The only thing is, if the rows and the columns are over one size of a field, so the field is.
The field is specified.
The same for all
yes.
Rows and columns.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, you say that okay. I'm going to use a field like that, and that's what you're trying to minimize. You don't want to use a big one. You want a small one. And then over that field, you specify three things. You specify how you compute heavy parities, and then specify the row code and the column code, and you get the code word and the product code. Yeah. So, in practice, so why would people use instantiation of topology like that? Well, because let's say that you would put your rows across different data centers. So every row resides in its own data center. So now if a row is gone, well, you get immediately, like every symbol now your data center is gone, but you get whatever you lost by just reading symbols in the other data centers. You use column redundancy. Symbols in a row, they are machines in a data center. So now let's say that in a row you experience some number of failures. Well, since you have redundancy in a row, this means that you don't need to go across data centers to recover what you lost. And that's a desirable property, because typically bandwidth across data centers is scarce. So you don't want to go to other data centers, you can stay within a data center. And then heavy parities are there for the reason that, well, you will get a lot of redundancy, a lot of reliability just from having row code and column code, but this might not be enough. You might want a little bit more, and so then to strengthen your reliability guarantees, you can plug in some, you can also use some heavy parities, so that if you experience some massive failures, then you will read everything, including heavy parities, you will do the reconstruction, and you will get what you want. So let me just mention that in some instantiations of these that are being run in the cloud, say, so Facebook, in their data center, they use a 314140 code in this notation. So these are three code words. So in a data center, it looks like a 10-14 code. So 10 data symbols, 4 redundant symbols, and then there is XOR going across 3 data centers. So I don't know if it's a maximally recoverable code. Microsoft Azure uses a 28102 code within data center. So these are groups of size 2 in every column with no redundancy, but then in every row you have one redundant symbol and there are two heavy parities. I don't know about Google and Amazon. They definitely do something, like most likely it's captured by this topology for some parameters. They're not open about what they do. Yeah.
Isn't 012 just exactly what you call the structure of the LRC?
Yes, I mean,
you put 0 in one of the first two parameters.
Yeah, you can put 0. 0 says just that in the column you don't have any column redundancy.
Right, but then does it feel like if you put 0 and 1, it sounds like just your LRC, right?
Oh, like the it is an LRC.
Okay.
Yeah, it is an LSK. Well, so in fact, in reality, the topology there, so here I say related, closely related. So the topology is very similar to that. There is some difference, but it's almost that. So, and again, we have all these definitions. We have a definition of maximal recoverability, naturally generalizing to this broader class of topologies. Right, so, okay, so let's say that I have two different instantiations. There is one way in that I can instantiate heavy packages in row code and column code, and then there is another way. And I can say that one way is better if every pattern which is correctable by the other instantiation is correctable by the first instantiation. Then the first one is better. And apparently in this order, there is the maximal element. So in existence, again, you prove by random assignment. So you prove that if you assign coefficients at random, then in fact, over a very large field or exponential size field, then in fact, that code would be maximally recoverable. So it would dominate any other instantiation. And this is what we want. Again, if we deploy it, we want it to be as reliable as possible, assuming that we can do it over a small field. So this is the general definition of maximal recoverability, and maximally recoverable codes exist, but the argument ends up asking for an exponentially sized field. And so there are a number of questions, but the main question is about this lower bound, upper and lower bounds, right? So we won't have explicit constructions over a small field. If we cannot get them, we want lower bounds. We want to say, okay, so we fail not because we didn't find it, but because there isn't good code. So then we have to sacrifice something. We should maybe change the topology, or do something else. So this is the main thing. So establish upper and lower bounds, and if you establish upper bounds, of course, one wants an explicit construction. A related question is just to understand what is correctable, right? So what are the patterns that a maximally recoverable code should correct? And that's apparently quite non-trivial if you ask this question in general. So we saw the answer in the case of MN10H topologies. But if you start having these local constraints in two dimensions, then even if H is zero, we don't know the answer in general. So we know the answer when A is 1 and B is arbitrary and H is 0. So then we know the answer. But if say A is 2, B is 2, and H is 0, we don't know the answer. We don't know even a combinatorial characterization of what is correctable, what is not correctable. So here is a brief summary of quantitative state of the art. So what do we really know about the field size for maximally recoverable codes and all these topologies? So if you look at the simplest topology, so 1N00H. So 1N means that there is no grid. Our symbols are just in kind of arranged in a straight line. And 00 means that there are no local parities. So, and there are H global parities. So just have our data symbols and H global parities attached. So this is just the setting of Reed-Solomon codes, right? So in this case, yeah, so Reed-Solomon codes give us an MR instantiation. Field size is linear, so field size is very good. Actually, one can argue that a random code, if you would want to assign coefficients at random, you would need an exponential sized field to get this MR property. So Reed-Solomon codes are really, really special. If you take a random code with the same number H of redundant symbols, if you would want to get the MDS property in a random code, you would need your field size to be exponential in H. So this is an observation of Kuparte and Mecca. So this says that, well, at least in some cases, you can do way better than random. So the fact that random need exponential size shouldn't be too discouraging. It's unfortunately, this is the only case where we know how to beat random by so much. So if we look at, if we have local constraints just in one direction, so H0, so the case of small h has been studied a lot. There are results for general h. But essentially, well, so there is kind of a trivial linear lower bound independent of H. And there are constructions which give you field size, which is M times N to the H minus 1. So this is roughly on par with what random codes do. So slightly, so we can improve upon random codes, but by really small quantities, by some, so it's almost the same behavior as for random codes. And this is already quite non-trivial. So just getting to random codes with an explicit construction turns out to be not that easy. And we don't know how to improve upon them. So even in the case of H equals 3, so their random already become, you need quadratic field size. Well, we know how to beat quadratic, but we don't know how to do linear field size. We don't know whether it's possible. So it would be really, really interesting to get an omega small of n, or omega small of quadrat length lower bound here. We don't have that, or to get better constructions. Now, very recently, so we, so, uh, Parikshit Gopalan, Gwanda Hu, Shubhangi Saraf, and Carol Wong, and myself. So we proved the first non-trivial lower bound for any topology. So prior to this work, there was no lower bound in any topology known. So we proved an n to the log n lower bound for the t n times n 111 topology. So now we know that at least in some cases, so yeah, maximal recoverability in general doesn't come for free. So while read-solemn codes in this topology do get it for free, so over linear size fields, in general this won't be the case. So you have to pay for it. This is a strong property and you have to pay for it. I seem to have another 10 minutes, so I'll talk a little bit about this proof. So what is this? What is this topology? So actually, this is I'm done with slides, so I'll just raise it and do it on the blackboard. Right. So here is the claim. Any maximally recoverable instantiation great. So first, let's think about. So what is that? So what is that topology? Right. So we have this. It's a square grid. Right. We have n symbols here and n symbols here, and then it's filled with data symbols, x1 and so on, up to x something. And then there is one heavy parity sitting here. So there are x's and then one heavy parity. And then we have row and column parities. So I'll write, so in general, I mean, this doesn't have to be a simple parity. This doesn't have to be a simple sum. It could have coefficients. In fact, when you look at this simple topology, it's without loss of generality. You can assume that these are simple XORs. It's a lemma. We will be proving it. So we have row parities and column parities. OK. No, and that no. If you like, you can try it. You can instantiate it with a parity, and it wouldn't work. Because if it would, then you would get an instantiation over a field of size 2. So in fact, the theorem doesn't allow that, right? Given that I already claimed that it's without loss of generality, assuming that you.
So far, we are only using constants 0 and 1.
Yeah. You need some other constants, yeah. So, let me reformulate this question, and I won't—it's a reduction, but again, I won't show the reduction. But I'll just claim that this problem is equivalent to some other problem, which does look very similar. So let me think of all these. Well, let me think of all symbols in this n by n grid as variables. So this will x 1 1, x 1 n minus 1. Here I would have x and n. So I would think of this, and I would think of dual constraints rather than thinking of this heavy parity, which is somehow computed from symbols, and then this row parities, column parities being somehow computed. I'll think of this in this kind of homogeneous dual way. I'll say that I have this collection of n squared variables, and I have some constraints on these variables. And then what are my constraints? Well, my constraints are the following. So for every I in n, I have the sum over j in n, xij is 0. Then for all j in n, sum over I in n, xij is 0. And then one dual constraint, saying that sum over ij, alpha ij times xij is 0. Yeah, yes, I should have said it, yeah. So throughout all this, it's not very important, so everything can be generalized to arbitrary fields, but its formulas are much nicer, and yeah, so in general, in practice, uses characteristic two, of course, I mean, because you store bits, so it's characteristic two. So I'm thinking of the following system of linear equations. I have n squared variables, and then I have two n equations that are specified for me, in fact, redundant equations, and then one special equation. that I get to design. So I have to pick this alphas ij. So those I pick myself. So I can pick them in any field of characteristic 2. I want a small field where I would be able to fix these alphas ij's. So I want to fix these alphas ij's so that any rate, so that basically whenever some of these variables, so that the system of linear equations would be solvable for any subset of these variables. So I want my assignment to be such that if my system of linear equations is solvable for some assignment for these variables, then it should be solvable for my assignment for these variables. So this is the assignment for alphas that I'm looking for. And rather, again, now I'll change my, so, and this is in fact equivalent. It's probably not that hard even to see the equivalence. So, but then I'll just slightly change the language. Probably this isn't even a reduction. So rather than thinking of a linear system, I will think of a bipartite graph. My complete bipartite graph, KNN, with weights on edges. So, and the weights are natural as alphas ij's, right? So these are weights on edges. So what is an erasure pattern, right? An erasure pattern is just some subset of edges, because edges, they correspond to coordinates. So edges correspond to coordinates in my matrix. So an erasure pattern is some subset of this coordinate, some collection of xij's being selected. So it gives me some subset of edges in this graph. So some subsets of edges are easy, right? Some erasure patterns are easy. Like if an erasure pattern has one symbol in a row, then you can immediately fix that symbol. So these are easy things, right? So the interesting cases are cycles. So in fact, okay. So I'll have to claim it. Well, I won't be able to show the proof anyways. But so claim. An instantiation. Instantiation specified by these alpha ij's in my field is MR is maximally recoverable if and only if every simple cycle. So let me call this graph G. So this is my graph with weights on edges. Every simple cycle in G carries non-zero weight. So I have this alpha as ij's that I use to specify my system of linear equations. And I can use this alphas ij's as weights on the edges in a complete bipartite graph. And I can ask the question, so here, when do I get an MR instantiation? Well, there is a lemma that it's not immediately obvious, but not very hard to show. In fact, it happens if and only if the following condition holds. If I look at this graph, in every simple cycle, so a cycle is simple if it doesn't visit the same node twice, right? So every simple cycle, and it cannot be decomposed, is there not two cycles, is it really one cycle? So every simple cycle should carry a non-zero weight. So if I take an arbitrary simple cycle and I sum all the weights along its edges, I should get a non-zero quantity. So if this holds, then my instantiation is in fact an MR instantiation. And if it doesn't hold, then it's not an MR instantiation. So this is the core mathematical claim. So after all this kind of coding theory and reductions, so this is the kind of the nice mathematical claim, mathematical question that one faces. So what is the smallest field over that one can make this assignment? And here one doesn't even need to think about the field. So you can think about because this is purely additive question. So just a linear space over F2. So now I'm out of time. So I won't be able to show the proof, and it wouldn't fit in short amount of time anyway. But this is what we argue. So we prove this claim, showing that if you do have such an assignment, then your finite field has to be somewhat large. Your finite field has to be of size at least n log n. And therefore, you get the lower bound for the first lower bound for field size of MR codes in any topology. It's plausible that one should be able to get a much stronger lower bound, actually an exponential lower bound. And then there are lots of questions about what happens in other topologies. Like, if we don't have any heavy pairs, so if you look at these topologies, say T, M cross N, A, B, 0, then, yeah, so then are there constructions over small fields? So what are they? Are there superlinear lower bounds? What are the correctable failure patterns? Is there combinatorial equilibration? All this is wide open. So, and with that, let me stop.
So you say that for this mm-hmm. claim to make every simple cycle non-zero weight, there is lower bound is n log.
Yes. So yes. So we can prove. So yeah, there's a lemma. If that holds, then t is at least log squared of n. Yeah. So.
And the upper bound?
Right. right. So the upper bound, 2n maybe? Yeah. N log n. N log n. Yeah. This is just coming from BCH codes. The way you would do this is by saying that, okay, so I have this grid of I look at these alphas, and I would assign them to be n independent, so that I would take a sum of any 2n independent, right? Sum up to some 2n of them, I should not see a zero. Now, a simple cycle can only include up to 2n of them, because like even if I visit every node, I would just collect 2n alphas. So this would be enough. Of course, simple cycles have a lot and lot of structure. We have no idea how to use it. If you want 2n independence, you get that through BCH, so you multiply by log n, so you get 2 log n. So 2n times log n. Yeah, so this is a vast gap.
So just you need to write bit vectors on every edge,
right.
So to get non-zero sum for every
simple cycle.
And still you have such a gap between...
Yeah, between upper and lower bounds. Yeah. Yeah, maybe you can close it. So in terms of construction, it's trivial. So construction is like real, construction is trivial, lower bound is non-trivial, but yeah, I don't know where the truth is. Maybe there is no good construction, maybe there is a good construction.
And if you take random things, what you get is
you will get about this. So. So you can remove 2 with BCH. So random would be 2n times log n, explicit is n times log n, and lower bound is log squared n.
Okay, any other questions or comments? So there is some kind of general, so I would say some kind of objection to the theory, mm-hmm. and you will tell me why it's not a real objection.
Mm-hmm.
So you know that each year the memory becomes, maybe 20% cheaper, and it looks that the difference between one XOR in a row or two XOR in a row is just less than 20%. So. Why should we care about such a big, why it's so a big deal to have only one parity instead of two, if a year later we will get, for the same price, we will get?
Well, because you get that on top of that. That's because I mean, if your machines become cheaper, it's good.
Okay, of course you can then use bigger disks also.
It's a competitive advantage. If you can provide the same service for less, that's a competitive advantage. That's why you care.
So just if you are just lazy and for a year you don't do anything,
you go out of business because you lose your customers.
All you can achieve.
I mean, if memory does become cheaper or electricity becomes cheaper. You will get savings from somewhere, but you lose your customers very quickly.
But still a bad management decision, which causes a year
more or less equivalent to all the theory. But probably it's more costly than the theory to predict it from the management.
Yeah, I mean, and but the. So, I mean, there are lots of trends, right? And like you can say that, yeah, I mean, why do you care about storing the current volumes? Like if you look 20 years back, say, the volumes were much less. Yeah, and then 20 years later.
Because it's like, you know, there is, you see a pile of junk accumulating somewhere. Of course, you can imagine a more effective ways of piling this junk in a better thing. But if most of the data are really junk, maybe it's better not to produce so many of them.
I mean,
for future archaeology, it's maybe very important. But nobody can read them. If you have this peta or this number, bytes of data, what can you do with them?
Right, you have machine learning that people are working on that processes it. You don't process it yourself, right? These are great questions, but honestly, out of scope.
It's even if it's completely useless, it's a nice theory. So maybe the more important part. Okay, let's say thanks.